Hello, everybody, and welcome to the latest edition of Music Motion, our first for 2023. We're thrilled to have all of you here, and I want to take a moment and just say hello to my partner in crime here, Olly Blackburn, who is, I am joining you all from Dallas area at UNT. Olly, I believe you're in Prague, is that correct?
I'm in Prague, yeah. Greetings.
Greetings.
Happy New Year
to you, my friend. We have a really interesting, I think is going to be a really interesting episode today, and very different from previous episodes where we've had a guest composer and really have done a deep dive into their personal work. Today's going to be something completely different, Olly. Do you want to tell everybody what we're doing today?
Yeah, today is the first of our Music Motion jukeboxes, and we started this because we love film, we love music, we love the combination of music and film and moving images, and it comes from pure passion. So what we're doing today and in future episodes of this jukebox is we're playing things that have really spoken to us and that have informed that love. And we're getting in some guests and some friends as well to show some clips that have really spoken to them. And we're going to just talk about them and dig into them and try and figure out what it is that really speaks to us in this kind of amazing fusion of music and visual arts.
The thing that's kind of exciting about today is we don't really know where the conversation is going to lead. We've picked out some clips, as you just said, Olly. Things that inspire us, things that we think represent well the ways in which music and image can really push narrative forward and storytelling. But we don't know what's going to happen in the conversation. So we want you all to be a part of that. Please, if you're on Twitch or YouTube or Facebook, any of those, if you send a direct message, we can actually engage you in the conversation today. And we really hope for this to be a hangout with everybody, not just Olly and I and the two great composers that we have as a special guest today. So please do chime in. Thank you, Undeniable Ops, for example. Hello. So we've got the engagement going already. Olly, we've got two just really wonderful guests, composers who are joining us in this conversation today. We have a former Music Motion guest and also a new friend. Would you introduce these wonderful composers, please?
I'd love to. So we have Ruth Barrett, who we interviewed last year, who's fresh off, I think, two or is it three new shows?
Hi, Ruth.
And hey, Ruth.
Hi. I don't know. I've lost count. Hi. So I was trying to send a tweet out about tonight, so which I have done now.
So we're gonna let Ruth go back
nice to see you guys.
To tweeting. Yeah, good to
go
see
back
you.
To tweeting. And Ruth speaking to us from London. And then we have a new friend. Her name is Julia Sokolowska. And she has just done the Ghislaine Maxwell documentary on Netflix, which has got a lot of people talking. Hello, Julia.
Hi, guys. Sorry, I don't know if I want to be known as that person who's on a witch hunt after Maxwell and Epstein and that and that crowd. Although it is like, you know, I refer to these shows a little bit with like a sense of pride, being like, you know, we are the good guys or good women. Well, and yeah, so thank you so much for having me. Hopefully we can talk about some more fun stuff today.
Julia, how do you feel about being known as a UNT alum?
Yay! I love that. That's much better. Although when I was at UNT, and I was just trying to make that joke earlier today, UNT seemed more like the Whiplash in the real life, where you have to be on time. And you have to count in 1, 2, and you have to come in perfectly. So that was the kind of UNT that I remember, where, you know, we were staying up all night and just, you know, working hard. And then you would lock yourself out for 9 hours in a practice room, because if you didn't, you wouldn't be able to make the 1 o'clock big band or other amazing ensembles that were at UNT. But overall, such an amazing school. And I just, you know, I just really, really want to go back there and just experience that thing over and over again. It's just such talent and, you know, and such versatility of different music influences that you can get there. Well, definitely recommend for everybody.
And Julie, it's just great having an alum on here. It's good for my students to see that people go out and they start making it professionally from UNT. So anyway,
absolutely.
So we have
it's Music Motion, and I'm a total nerd, but Julia is also the Christoph Komeda scholar from her music school in Poland, which some of our listeners may know. Christoph Komeda is the ultimate super cool cult East European composer who tragically died young.
Yeah, I am so impressed that you know that that you know that person, Olly. Like, that was when we talked about this a little earlier, I was just like, wow, it's probably the only person on, well, you're on the other side of the globe, but I'm on the side of the globe that, you know, and I barely ever get to even like bring up that name and be able to talk about his work.
Well,
we're going to have to, knife in the water.
Yeah.
To be continued. Ruth, of course, Ruth was one of our great guests, one of our early guests last year. Ruth, how have you been since we saw you last?
Yeah, it's been a bit of a time. Pretty busy, actually, but really good.
Tell us, please.
I've been doing a nature show for the last few months, actually, which has just wrapped up, which is completely different to, I think I was just finishing off the terminal list, which is, we just released, actually, plug, as a soundtrack. And then it went on to Cuddly.
And Ruth, where might one want to buy the terminal list?
Agenda? Moi? Being on this show, you can get it all streaming platforms, iTunes and everything. Yeah. actually, it took ages to release it as well, but it's finally come out, and there might be other news soon, which I'm not allowed to say about. But the nature show was really fun because that was completely different and kind of just different style of music and quite orchestral and, but still about being with the animals, you know, like I wanted to score it a bit like a drama rather than, you know, watching the animals from afar. I wanted to feel like you're kind of hanging out with them, almost like hanging out with Chris Pratt, really up close and personal with the bear, you know? So I got some pretty outlandish ideas through, but it's still pretty lush as well. But that was quite exciting. And now I'm doing some dark comedy thing, which is about to start. So, and a film and some other things. So, yeah, my hair's is slowly sizzling.
We expect to continue to see great things coming from you, Ruth, and from you too, Julia. And we really just appreciate you taking a little time on this Sunday. Well, Sunday afternoon and Sunday evening, I guess. We've got Julia from Los Angeles. I'm in Dallas. Ruth from London and Olly in Prague. So we've got some geography covered there.
We're going afternoon, evening, night.
That's right.
And we're all drunk. No,
not drunk. Absolutely.
Just me. I mean, it's 9 p.m. here, so. Well, you've got a baby, so I guess, you know, you can't.
Oh, yeah, we can't hear the baby right now.
Don't wait.
Julia's got a beautiful 9-month-old little girl. We all got to see during the tech check earlier. But anyway, there's going to be so much to discuss today. And as we mentioned early on, this is really informal. So please just jump in with any comments or thoughts or ideas. We've got an idea about how to get started here. Those of you, again, who are watching online, please DM if you have any comments about the clips that we're playing. This is going to be really fun, and we should jump in, I think. Right, Olly?
Yeah.
So who are we starting with today, Olly? How are we going to start?
Well, we're going to start with Hitchcock, of course.
Yes, I mean, of course.
What question's that? Of course it's going to be Hitchcock. Yeah, and we're going to do, I mean, it's like, you know, you start with the Stones. So we are going to do a Hitchcock back-to-back. We're going to start off with Vertigo, which Drew, I think, is one of your selections. And then we're going to go to a selection from Ruth from another Hitchcock movie.
So... Absolutely. And just as a bit more of a preamble here. So when you think of, you know, as a film composer, when you think of Alfred Hitchcock, you also have to be thinking of Bernard Herrmann in the same way that you would think of Steven Spielberg and John Williams. Right. And Bernard Herrmann is a great composer to start with because he is such an important figure in film music. He really established a lot of what all of us, any of us working, making music for media, he kind of wrote a lot of the playbook. And some of that is definitely represented in some of these early clips. So, Olly, what do you think? Do you want to play, which one of those Vertigo clips do you want to play? Should we play the spinning Vertigo and death scenes and then do the dream sequence after that?
Yeah, let's do that. It's okay. Two different sort of, you know, tastes of the palette.
So what we're listening for here, what we're observing, one of the reasons I chose this clip is that Bernard Herrmann does a great job in these films of choosing musical motives that kind of represent ideas. So the protagonist in Vertigo has vertigo, and there are some musical devices that you hear. There are a number of deaths in the film, and there's this kind of low-sounding, ominous set of two notes that represents death. This stuff is peppered throughout the film. So this is just a sampler of, I'm calling this clips Spins and Death. These are clips from Vertigo. Here we go. This is the iconic dream sequence from Vertigo.
Mm-hmm.
Well, for me, I mean, there's so much going on here. First of all, the music is taking such an active role in communicating so much about what's going on with the story, about what's going on in the mind of the protagonist, and doing it in such a cool artistic way. Olly, during the sound check, we were talking the tech check. You were talking about how Vertigo was a bit of a failure as a commercial release, but the kinds of things that Bernard Herrmann is doing here in terms of the utilizing this to identify death anytime it happens, and the descending. That kind of walking down into death. There's so much that's going on in terms of the shape of the musical motives that represents both the ideas of what's going on in the story, but then also again what's going on in the mind, and therefore suggesting what maybe could be going on in the mind of the listener and viewer. So I just think it's really exciting stuff.
Now, is it true? Because I've heard. Not a criticism, but an observation about Bernard Herrmann was that he only used a very specific amount of chords and instrumentation, that he, he was not an expansive composer. Is that something that you detect and you agree with? And by the way, that's not a criticism. That many people might say that makes him a very focused composer.
I would love to hear Ruth's impressions of that, but I can just say that I've never really felt that to be the case. I think good composers, good film composers, are very deliberate in what they're doing, and utilizing an economy of music materials. You don't have to use a lot of different things to create a lot of meaning and create a lot of support for the story narrative, and by using a very specific. Curated selection of musical materials. I don't see how that undermines the purpose of the film at all. Ruth, what do you think of that critique of Bernard Herrmann?
Yeah, I mean, I think when we move on to Psycho, that's a different story because he chose a much smaller palette because of various reasons, which you were talking about earlier, Olly, like the film not having as much budget as Vertigo. So. And also that it was filmed in black and white, so he decided to make a score that was just using the strings, so it had more of a monochrome sort of sound. In this one, there's more in the palette, so it's like he's just using what's right, I think, for what he feels is right or suits the film, which is like dreamy, then you want more of an orchestra, maybe different kinds of colors in the sound as well. And I just love like those crunchy chords. They're just kind of jazzy, that are just so everyone, they've become so part of the vernacular of film composition, those kind of thriller chords, I guess, which are kind of just really, really crunchy. And I noticed about the score that he like used a little bit of Wagner in the score. And Wagner was the first one to kind of break away from what was known as traditional harmony when he did Tristan and Isolde and actually did the first chord, which was no one could pin down to say it's in what key it was in or anything. They couldn't analyze it. And I think he's jumped right off the back of that, and he's using chords that kind of sound cool, but there's no sort of harmonic. Always a harmonic basis to it, which is what makes it feel so disembodied and psychotic, and like that's where you feel like you're kind of free falling with him. But yet he's also really progressive as well. Like if you listen to that very end section when he's falling, there's a kind of repetitious motif, and that's quite modern, I think, to almost loop a motif and repeat it again and again. I just think is crazy for the time to think of something like that. And that's what also you can hear in what I'm going to show in Psycho. He does that. It's really kind of modern and cool. He's just so ahead of his time, but also like part of the past as well.
You know, should we go straight to Psycho on that note? Because then we can talk about them as a, you know, as a sequence.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Olly, can you give us a little bit of, as a director, can you talk about the significance of these two films from a director's perspective, and then we'll get into the music and see how that kind of plays into it for Psycho.
Yeah. So I'll just to be quick, Psycho was, so Vertigo, as you alluded to, was a disaster. It was a commercial disaster, and it's one of these films that now is legendary and is seen as a classic, but at the time did no business. It freaked out the studio executives, and it meant that following on from that, Hitchcock, you know, wasn't being given the amount of money that he was used to. So he also felt really burnt by the process. So he felt he needed to go back to basics and come out with something that was low budget, that he had complete control over, and that would really, really shake things up for him as an artist. So he came out with Psycho, which cost $1 million, which for him was not very much, which apart from Vivian Leigh, Janet Leigh, who gets killed after 20 minutes, didn't have any major stars in it. Tony Perkins wasn't a star at the time. He became a star because of Psycho. And that translated to the score as well. Bernard Herrmann did not have the money for a full orchestra. So with that in mind, let's play the Psycho clip.
Just put it in here, please. Thank you.
Heck, officer, that was the first time I ever saw the customer high-pressure the salesman. Somebody chasing her?
I better have a look at those papers, Charlie.
She looked like a wrong one to you?
Acted like one.
The only funny thing, she paid me $700 in cash.
Yes, Mr. Lowry.
Carolyn? Nine still isn't in?
No, Mr. Lowry, but then she's always a bit late on Monday mornings.
Buzz me the minute she comes in. Call her sister. No one's answering at the house.
I called her sister, Mr. Lowry, where she works. The music maker's music store, you know. And she doesn't know where Marion is any more than we do.
You better run out to the house. She may be unable to answer the phone.
Her sister's going to do that. She's as worried as we are.
I haven't the faintest idea. As I said, I last saw your sister when she left this office on Friday. She said she didn't feel well and wanted to leave early. I said she could. That was the last I saw. Wait a minute. I did see her sometime later driving. I think you'd better come over here to my office, quick. Carolyn, get Mr. Cassidy for me. After all, Cassidy, I told you, all that cash. I'm not taking the responsibility. Heaven's sake, girl works for you for 10 years, you trust her. All right, yes, you better come over.
Well, I ain't about to kiss off $40,000. I'll get it back, and if any of it's missing, I'll replace it with her fine, soft flesh. I'll track her, never you doubt it.
Oh, hold on, Cass. I still can't believe it. Must be some kind of a mystery. I can't.
You check with the bank, no? They never laid eyes on her, no? You still trusting? Hot creeper, she sat there while I dumped it out. Hardly even looked at it. Planning and even flirting with me.
Thank you.
the actress, the character in that we're watching there, she has just stolen money from her employers. And she's in a strange sort of dysfunctional relationship, and she's escaping town. And she's going to end up in the Bates Motel, and the rest is history.
Yeah, so we're on one bit of the story, which hasn't even got to the juicy bit where she's about to get killed. She's already in this kind of like having an affair with this guy who shouldn't be, because he hasn't got any money. So why is she even having an affair with him? Jeez, you know.
Where's the incentive there?
Oh, he's very good looking. No, he's very good. Yeah. Anyway. Okay. So she's got the money, but I just really think that whole sequence is there's literally nothing happening. She's just driving. You have her expressions and you have some of the voices in her head of what's going on and her anxiety, but the music is really telling the whole story. And it's just not only saying this woman's just stolen money and she's anxious about it, but it's kind of giving you this sort of precursor to this really shocking event, which is literally just around the corner. And so he almost sets something up and then just completely pulls the rug again, which I just think is so clever. And I just, the music is quite upfront and in your face in terms of it's like another character in the story almost. And I just really like the way he's using, so we'd mentioned he's just using strings and they have mutes on all the time. So the sound is a bit more sort of slightly more muffled than when strings are playing normally. So it has this sort of, it gives a kind of impression of feeling a bit more like it's internal or underwater or something. So that the way they're playing almost quite abrasively, but with mutes, it's like she's got all this raging anxiety, but it's inside her. It's kind of got that sort of feeling to it. And the sort of, again, those repetitious, they're sort of repetitious motifs, quite modern, give you really kind of set that anxiety feeling off, and the way it kind of has distinct sections that just keep going back and forth, like her thoughts, she keeps going, thinking about the same things in rotation until it kind of reaches that crescendo as the rain comes down, and notice how the windscreen wipers go in time with the track, which is again so clever as it kind of reaches this astonishing climax when really all she's doing is pulling up to the hotel, which is should be a safe place because she's moving away from the cops and everything. But yeah, it's going, okay, don't make a cup of tea now because something terrible's going to happen. And well, and I, you know, the one time, just to finish this a little bit, is the one time the strings don't play with mutes is during the shower scene, which is probably the most famous horror scene ever in the history of film music, where the strings are just they're not playing with mutes there, so that the strings suddenly jump into focus and like you literally kind of fall off your chair.
I love the shower scene.
The shower scene.
No, I was just going to say that the shower scene originally wasn't
going to have music in it. It was never going to have music.
And Hitchcock said, yeah. No, it'll be much more powerful if there's no music. And Herman was like, well, I've got something great planned. And Hitchcock was like, no. And you never argued with Hitchcock. And then they played it. And Hitchcock said to Bernard Herman, you know, I think we need music. And Herman was like, I've got just the thing. But what made you change your mind? And Hitchcock went, well, you know, we all make mistakes.
I love that you brought up the foreshadowing. Like, in reality, this is what's happening in the scene. She's just going on a drive and showing up at a hotel. Like, it shouldn't be that consequential. But the music, and I think in horror especially, like that genre, music does this a lot. I'm thinking of the opening to The Shining, for example, right? That amazing synth score. I wish we could pull it up right now, but it foreshadows, like, it's just a beautiful drive through this canyon, but it's, you know, it foreshadows things that are about to come. And those little stabby in Psycho, those kind of stabby string sounds are completely kind of in the family musically of the iconic, you know, stabbing scene. So there's this foreshadowing of what's going to happen with her, which is a really powerful kind of subconscious storytelling that the music is doing for us, right?
Yes, exactly like that in The Shining. Because you could have something really light. Like sometimes in a horror film, they start off with something really upbeat to sort of lull you into this. You know, it's like you could do the opposite. But I think it's so powerful when you set it up and then you just don't know when shit's going to go down. You know, it's like really tense.
It's also, it's really internal, that scene. Like, you're not clear, you know, all the voiceover, you're not clear whether that's actually happening or that's her paranoia in her head. And, you know, there's this whole aspect, you know, any great artist, Hitchcock was digging deep into the culture that he was from. And, you know, 1950s America had this kind of sort of Norman Rockwell exterior. And there was this whole sort of dark underbelly that when just that image of Janet Leigh, you know, the makeup isn't quite right. She's sort of got this paranoia in her head. She's stolen money. And it just sort of digs underneath this sort of false perfection of kind of... And I think that was the power of Psycho, was that no one had ever seen a film like that before. No one had ever got as dark as that. No one had ever killed off their lead character in the first 20 minutes. And yeah. No one had ever used strings like that.
I love how her expression changes as well, because she looks like a sort of like she could be innocent and she's very pretty and everything. And then as she's, I think it is the voices in her head, because like nearly at the end of the drive, she kind of like starts going, or I might just get away with this shit, you know, stupid sods, because, you know, they're all like typical men in that time, just taking her for granted, just flirting with her, and she just sees an opportunity. And I just think it's just really, it's a really cool film at the time. It's just so modern. You're like, yeah. And then she gets killed, which is not so good, but... Poor Janet.
Well, this is great. And, you know,
I couldn't watch that film, you know, because I spent most of my childhood with my parents going on and on about how it was the scariest film they'd ever seen. And kind of acting out all the scariest bits, you know, the shower scene, the Martin Balsam scene. And I couldn't bring myself to watch the film until I was like 18 or 19, because I was so terrified by it, just hearing about it.
And then what was it like when you watched it? Were you terrified, or were you over it by then?
It was pretty scary. The other film that was like that was Alien, you know. I remember at school, everyone talking about that film. And when I finally watched it, it was as terrifying as they'd said.
But it is that thing of setting up a whole world, isn't it? So it's like, and the music does that, doesn't it? It just sets that, which in your clip, The Vertigo as well, it just takes you into that space and makes you feel like just really uneasy and really unsettled the whole time. And it just doesn't let you off the hook at all. And it's those kind of chords that he uses. There's just no respite. There's no resolution. There's no like breath.
We have a comment from Shannon here. Why did my parents use the same scare tactic?
Excellent. Parents are bastards.
Well, yeah, this is a great way to start off. Thanks, Ruth. Undeniable
obsession. I just love that film. It's such a great study, isn't it?
It's amazing. It's amazing.
It's amazing. And you know, it changed, you know, horror. The slasher film comes from that film, you know, Texas Chainsaw, everything comes from that film. It completely revolutionized horror. And you can't separate, and this is why we're doing this, you can't separate the music from that equation.
Imagine this scene without the music, right? Imagine the scene. It'd just be some, you know, she'd be driving
Hitchcock did, and he demanded music.
Right.
I don't think you wouldn't stay the course of the scene, because it's a long scene and there's nothing happening.
Right.
You know? So it's like, this is the stuff you dream about, working with, some, you know, a collaboration like that. It's so cool.
Well, this is great. We've gotten through two
and
films.
And hi to Shannon and Undeniable Ops, by the way. They're
yes, thanks for chiming in. Please DM.
Friends.
Please DM and we'll put your comments on air. Yeah, Undeniable Ops says you can't rely on the ambience of a car engine.
Okay.
Yeah. All directors who say like we like realism and natural sounds and like, come on.
Okay, so talking about that, I'd like to move us out from the dark atmospherics of Hitchcockian thrillers to the bright open space of a spaghetti western, and I'd like to play a choice of my own, which is a clip from For a Few Dollars More.
When the chimes end, pick up your gun. Try and shoot me, Colonel. Just try.
Okay, so
classic.
So just a little bit of context for anyone out there who hasn't seen this film. Lee Van Cleef and Clint Eastwood are two bounty hunters, and they're hunting this truly evil psychopath who you just saw get shot. And Lee Van Cleef has this musical clock this, you know, that plays this tune that he plays throughout the film, and that Indio also has one. And it turns out that Indio killed particularly savagely Lee Van Cleef's sister. And there's a previous scene where Indio does the same thing. He plays the tune on the clock to a rival and says, you know, when the song ends, we shoot, and he kills him. So it's, this is a, you know, the final culmination of all of those things. It's just, it's a classic. We have a comment here. Shannon says it's the last kind of music you would expect for a shootout. It's so gentle. And that's one of the things that makes it so incredible, is the timeless kind of fairy tale context of that musical rhythm coming from the clock, and the way that it starts in this really pared down diegetic way, and then Leone and Morricone bring it up, you know, throughout the scene, and then they bring in all this extra instrumentation, and it becomes, you know, truly epic. But it's epic, and all that you're seeing are people's faces. You know, it's a scene that spends, like so much of Leone's stuff, it spends 4 minutes of drama and of kind of, you know, pathos getting to a, you know, a final killing, someone getting shot, but all the drama takes place in slowing time down with the music and getting into people's eyes and faces, quite literally. I'm gonna have to leave it to That's you guys a... to explain musically what's going on.
I just want to say that you guys have such amazing selections for this episode. It's just, I feel like this is like a classic after a classic after a classic, and I actually can't believe you, out of all the Morricone movies, you pulled out that, like, that iconic scene.
Well, you know, and like a lot of things, you know, like what we're talking about with Psycho, this entered into the popular culture. Like, you know, when the chimes end was used in hip hop tracks, you know, that tune was used in house tracks. And, you know, an iconic scene is just an iconic scene. And I think what this scene shows is not being afraid to just let the music rule. You know, there comes a moment where... Now, can you guys explain...
The music is more iconic than the scene, isn't it?
Yeah.
I just love the way it slows down so much at the end. It's like... And it's just the chime. It's just so cool. It's like the French Kiss track. you know what I mean?
Right! Dun, 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 it is!
I think it sparked it off. It must have inspired so much. I did it in Terminal List as well, like just how much you could slow something down and speed it up again, because I just think it's such a cool device, because it just kind of draws your attention right into that moment of like... You know, and it's such a delicate instrument as well. It's
unusual, and she does it twice, because there's that bit in the middle where you think it's about to end, and then Clint Eastwood comes in, and then he ramps up the music, and it gets huge with, you know, God knows what, you know, maracas and jew's harp, and, you know, and choral and stuff, and then he brings it down really, really bare bones again.
Yeah, also, if I could point out that, like, how beautifully these melodies that he finally introduces, these themes that he finally introduces, then later on just kind of carry the, almost glorifies the picture.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, go ahead, Ruth.
Yeah, no, it gives it honor, and, you know, it gives it... Like you say, it gives it sort of dignity. It raises it up to be to this level of importance, and this kind of like between these two guys, you know, gives it power. And then he invented, like, we were talking about tropes earlier, and like the spaghetti western has become like this massive trope, hasn't it, of those sounds. But he invented those sounds. Like, he was the first one that used those trumpets and that kind of guitar sound and the, you know, the characteristic singing that's not in that clip, but everybody knows, you know, that kind of yodeling.
Yeah.
Where did he get that from? And he, you know, it's almost like Leone, I guess, gave him that canvas to go, like, just find some shit that sounds like you're in the desert, but, you know, it's head to head, you know, so it's got to have this complete, like, drama of, like, kill or be killed, but also the sort of sound of being out there, and it's a bit kind of... bit cray cray, cray cray. Yeah, I said that.
Well,
I mean, so I would love to say, I would love, and I'd actually love to hear from Ruth and Julia on this as well. You know, one of the things that we love to do making music for media is in this kind of situation is creating tension. And sometimes creating tension comes from being counterintuitive. Like the sound of the music box, right, is completely counterintuitive to what's going on. This is a pretty like intense moment. And there's this delicate music box timbre that's kind of taunting us in a way, right? Like the music is playing anti to what's going on. And I'd love to hear from Ruth and Julia, your thoughts about that, about how composers will sometimes do this. They'll work actually against what's going on, whether it's something musical or just an instrument that you're choosing. Would either of you like to say something about that?
Rarely happens recently, just because everybody following Hans Zimmer's suit, I think recently music shifted toward, you know, kind of removing itself from the picture. So scoring something like that is a very bold choice, and you have to almost be famous already to be able to pull it off. You know, it's one of those things where, you know, all the clips that we have over here really kind of show, you know, and also with the Pee Wee's Big Adventure, as we'll see in a minute, like they show how these bold choices were so applicable back then, and they really make the picture work, even though it is a bold choice, you know. And then after, I guess, maybe the 90s, you know, going into 2000s and on, the music started, you know, there was more and more calls from the studios to be like, why don't we just hide the music in the background? You know, why don't we let the picture speak for itself? So the whole notion of film scoring kind of ended up changing a little bit.
Right. I agree with that. And I just like to ask you guys about, because it feels to me that, you know, that clip we just saw comes from an era where melody was really embraced in film, with like Morricone and with John Barry. And as Julie has just been saying, you know, styles have changed, tastes have changed, and a melody has gone out of film scoring. And in fact, as Julia was saying, I think it's so out of fashion that if you were to put a melody in a film, you would have to be someone pretty famous, just because it's not what people are used to. They will get quite freaked out by it. I think if you were to do something like that now, it would be very difficult in this era of Franz Zimmer and Johan Johansson and Olafur Arnalds and all this incredibly sophisticated but really kind of textural film music.
Yeah.
Ruth, what do you think?
Bring it back.
Yay! Bring back the melody.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was actually scoring this little film recently that was temped with Morricone's music. And we had this scene at the fireplace where there was just a conversation between two pirates, and I actually ended up underscoring the whole dialogue with melodies that show in and up from under. And I actually took a lot of inspiration from the older scores, and I'm lucky because the director was willing to kind of experiment with me that way. But if it was a big studio film, the first note would be probably too much melody. Can we take it out? It's interrupting with the dialogue, you know? So it's really interesting how you could do that. And there is a lot of films where you have dialogue and the melody is helping the dialogue. You know, the melodies are kind of just kind of hiding in and out and altering what the people are talking about, right? Something that's almost not seen anymore.
Yeah, I think I love it when you can do that, and because I really love it when you can have a theme for a character and you associate that theme with the character, and then it comes back in different ways and kind of weaves in and out of their story, and you hear it on different instruments and it kind of carries you through the film. I think it's really kind of, I think it's just like a really successful way of scoring and helping people, guiding them through the film, you know. So I'm all for that, and I try and do that whenever you're allowed, you know what I mean? Like, rather than, yeah, the music's just got to be this kind of little bit of gentle tumbleweed or wallpaper going on in the background, classy, expensive wallpaper, but, you know.
Yeah.
No, we're better than that. But you know what I mean? That's not to say that's what music's like now, in film scoring's like nowadays at all. But I think those bolder choices, it's... And in fact, the other clip that I chose for tonight, I think, does show a more contemporary, bold choice. But again, came from a collaboration between a director looking for somebody to come along and kind of rip things up a bit and give him something a bit more unexpected and maybe had a little bit more time to play with as well. So you're not under that sort of pressure of delivering something, yeah, that does the job, but really kind of like digs into the story more and finds something that you wouldn't just pluck out of the air, you know. And I think that's something really special. And maybe it wasn't a big budget film, it was quite a low budget film, so maybe there was a little bit more room for experimentation, you know.
Yeah, well, there's an interesting thing about the low budget stuff. I don't know if you guys know it, but I think that in these times of Bernard Herrmann and Ennio Morricone and other older composers of the 20th century, when there was no budget, there was a lot of initiative going on from there. And for example, Ennio Morricone was known for booking what I would say was like first library music ever created, which is just essentially booking an orchestra for an hour and recording these batches of, you know, 1 minute, 2 minute, 5 minute, 10 minute, you know, different clips. And he would just, you know, just record it and have it. And then, you know, if there was no budget in a movie, he would just use that to score the film. So it's, you know, it's really interesting how lack of budget in the past was really ending up in very creative notions coming up from these composers.
This is great. And obviously we could have a whole discussion about the role in which music libraries now play a significant role in production workflows now, especially for TV commercials, for example, which I have a couple of friends who kind of direct exclusively commercials, and they almost never hire a live composer because libraries are the quickest way for them to get what they need. But we could digress on that. Ruth, I'd love to, I really want to get to Julia's example. There's a more lighthearted example from Pee-wee's Big Adventure. But Olly, I'm wondering if we might have Ruth share one of her clips. When you're talking about Under the Skin, this kind of greater level of collaboration, Ruth. Was this a natural segue?
Yeah,
maybe
yes.
We do that.
Okay, we want to stay in the dark place.
let's do one more
actually,
dark.
Actually,
what do you think, Olly? Well, you're the DJ
well,
here.
No,
I'm sorry.
I was going to say, I think if we're talking about collaboration, let's go to Pee-wee's Great Adventure, because it was the start of one of the most legendary collaborations that still exists between Danny Elfman and Tim Burton. And Tim Burton actually plucked Danny Elfman from a band in LA. He'd never done a soundtrack before to do the music for Pee-wee's Big Adventure. And although it's a completely different modality to what we've been watching and what we're going to watch with Ruth's clip, it's another example of all the clips that we've shown so far are these incredible collaborations with composers and directors Herman Hitchcock, Leone Morricone, and now Burton Elfman.
Awesome. Here we go. Brilliant. And Julia, you can fill us in on why you chose this clip for our discussion today. Here we go. Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Me too. Come on, let's get some breakfast. Come on.
Thank you.
So good.
That's brilliant.
So good.
Right. That's really good. So I guess, you know, there's so many things to say about this clip that I don't even know where to start. But since all you mentioned the collaboration between Danny Elfman and Tim Burton, and this is, you know, the very beginning of their collaborations, and it was first movie for Danny that, you know, that actually put him on a map. And I was just kind of thinking, you know, there's, so I'm going to speculate a lot, but I'm also going to give you guys some actual, knowledge about, you know, the actual factual knowledge that from the stuff that I know about Danny and this piece of music. And so knowing this is, I'm going to start with the speculation. I think that who called out for this type of music for this clip was Tim Burton. And my speculation is Tim Burton was very influenced by Nico Rota, who was an Italian composer, who did this very quirky Italian music. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, Fellini's 8.5. And that's a very, very old reference. I doubt Danny, coming from a pop music world, would know that clip. And it's for Charlotte's Gallop. And that's an orchestral piece that was written by Nico. And it's very, the way that the melody is kind of really boom, 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 da, 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 da. It's very heavy-handedly written. That actually comes from that clip. And so my imagination takes me to Tim Burton coming to Danny being just like, okay, this is kind of what I'm envisioning for it. I doubt there was a temp track action going on at that time, but I think he was just kind of like, hey, so can we use something like this and do a darker version of that? And I don't know if you guys are, you know, familiar with Danny and kind of I know everybody knows him from Oingo Boingo, but I don't know if anybody knows him as like a personal person. I actually got a chance to be in his house and, you know, and see how, you know, his personality, and he's literally like a live version of all these characters that he's been writing music for. He's like this dark, quirky person. He has a cat in his living room that's, you think it's a real cat, you go to pet that cat and it turns out to be a staffed dead cat. So
like a real dead cat.
A taxidermied cat. Okay, yeah.
Yep. It's a very freaky thing.
That's freaky.
That's awesome.
Yep, and then you go through a corridor with like these, you know, Chucky dolls, and it's dark in there, and it's just a really creepy house. So, it's definitely Daddy, you know. And as much as, you know, Bernard Herrmann is much more old school, dark personality, musicians hated working with him because he would yell at trumpet players at the session, you know. So, Daddy, on the other hand, is just like, you know, very, very, goofy, weird, dark, quirky character. And so, you know, when he writes this piece of music, it's a weird, quirky, dark piece of music, because, you know, he would, you know, he starts from this, you know, jazz type of duality, you know, he goes from like this, he starts in his, I'm sorry, he starts in his F, can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can barely hear the piano, but, so he starts in F sharp, of course. My speculation, another speculation, is that he actually written in a G flat, because why not? And then, you know, then when you go into that, you know, duality between major and minor, right? You go from G flat major to G flat minor with, you know, the A being a double flat there, right? Because why not? That's what probably Danny would write for
these
musicians.
That's a tough key. That's really tough key. Lots of flats.
Yeah. So you know, so you have these, you know, and then you have this bluesiness that, you know, came from his, you know, him being, you know, a blues musician to a certain extent. And, you know, I could play a little bit more, but I doubt we have all this time to really digress into this piece. But I definitely recommend for everybody to just kind of like go through the different, you know, modes and options that he's presented in there. And, you know, another thing that I guess would be really interested again to hear in this clip is the fact that the form is not really a form that you would, you know, meet in jazz or you would meet in pop music. You know, you don't have, you know, verse and a chorus, you don't have AAB, right? You have the intro, then you have the machine theme, and then you have the bombastic dinosaur theme, which is orchestrated. And then, you know, he has, you know, this orchestra that comes in, and the orchestra starts as like, okay, well, we have an orchestra and some toys. And then you have like a whole orchestra playing, and like the drummer going, you know, on the snare, just going bam 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 bam, and the plates just, you know, just going bam bam bam. So you really have a very weirdly organized tune that is dictated by nothing other than the picture. Yeah,
it's
so
really
that's
cool how it goes, like, from that big thing you just said to like really, really small, like one instrument, ding 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 ding, and then back to the big thing again. It's but very like precisely. But so it sounds like it's like the wheels are coming off the bus, but it's just done in a really, like you say, like really organized kind of chaotic,
yeah.
But just hangs together beautifully. It's really cool.
It does have
so Danny
kind of
Elfman,
a
no one else's style, is it?
Yeah, right.
Well, you know, I love
the Nino Rota piece again, Julia. What was the reference track you said again? What was it that you said it was a Nino Rota?
Oh, it was
track
it was that Charlotte's Gallop.
Oh, I've got to listen to that.
Yeah, I mean,
do you know which film it's from?
Fellini's 8 and a Half. It's a very, very old Italian film. It's black and white. And you know, I recommend everybody, if you don't want to watch the whole film, at least watch the just see the Charlotte's Gallop and how that plays out in that movie. That's a very, very interesting reference to this. But of course, as much as, you know, Nico was, you know, a very classically trained Italian composer, and so he goes into this, even if he uses a little bit of, you know, alterations, he still ends up in this beautiful grandiose tonal way, right? Danny doesn't. Danny stays in the, you know, he goes from from this little funny, you know, G flat major minor going to your E, a D sharp or E flat, right? Major, going straight back to like a very, very dominant sounding diminished chord, right? So he's using the blues instead, and he really doesn't care about ending in any tonal way, you know. And he starts off with like a little just a very, very simple F sharp pentatonic scale, you know, or G flat pentatonic scale. So he's just being all over the place in the Danny style.
So,
but yeah, it sounds quite listenable. You know, it doesn't sound atonal. It's like you totally want to be on this crazy bus.
Yeah,
that's
right.
What's so great about it. Yeah, he's like found his own. It's like discovering a new musical language from something
exactly
that's happened before. Like you say, bits of blues, but pop, but not.
Yeah, right.
You know,
and
yeah,
I feel like what's also really, really brilliant about this thing, but I think it just kind of happened by accident. This piece of music doesn't necessarily, it's not scored in a way where it like really lines up with the cuts, right? So nowadays, you know, especially with the Hans Zimmer world, everything has to be like, you know, matching the cut with the editor, right? So, you know, there's, of course, it's not written completely outside of the picture. He's hitting certain notes here and there, but it's not exactly aligning with that scene, right? And also, it's very, if you kind of know, you know, if you've been in this world for a while and if you listen to the ending of it, the music just kind of goes out and then it leaves us with no music. And it's almost like a shocker. It's just like, oh, there was this piece here a second ago and now we don't have the music anymore. So the transition out of this clip is very, very interesting because it really leaves you thinking, where did the music go?
There's so much energy and then it just kind of trickles out. It kind of makes
right.
it, a subtle inconspicuous
it's
exit.
Like, it's the sound of his head, isn't it? It's like, that's what I think it is. It's like this guy's...
All over the place.
It's like this an inventor's brain is like thinking about all these different types of machines, you know, that's... It's really clever like that. It's almost existing alongside the picture. In its own, and just as complicated as the picture is, as what you're seeing, but yet your brain can digest both things, and both things are sort of telling you something about the character, which is what gives me hope for
exactly.
Like, let's bring this back around again, you know.
Yeah.
Let's push the boundaries.
I mean, it's such a great clip, and I love the story about the taxidermy cat. I'm going to be thinking about that all the rest of the day. And, you know, Olly, like one of the things that kept coming up last year during all of our interviews where it was when we asked composers to give advice to aspiring composers, one of the things we heard was, you know, be yourself, figure out what you're about, figure out your sign, your sound rather. And, I mean, Danny Elfman, what better example is there? I mean, you can't think of Tim Burton without that sound, right? And as Julie has pointed out, that that's not just like he didn't just construct that. He's just, that's who he is. That seems like a really, really significant piece of this.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's you amazing know, yeah. to have yes. that courage and permission to pull that out of somebody and let that happen, you know, as a director, to let that be expressed and encourage that is just what should happen. Really, like, that's true artistry, isn't it?
Yeah.
And also, going back to what I said before, that was the first score Danny Elfman ever did. You know, he'd never scored for film before. He'd been in, you know, bands.
He did have one small film before. That was, I believe it was like either a horror movie or a comedy, but it wasn't a major film. It wasn't with a major director or a major producer. So technically it was his second film.
Right. But either way, to come in so bold, I mean, it's such a bold, you know, it's the start of the film as well. And he's not, you know, he's not subtly sort of, you know, feathering you into the film. He's like hitting you really hard from the start. And listening to it, I kept thinking that the music is so maximal that it feels like, you know, the strings are going to break on the instruments at any moment, or, you know, the drum's going to kind of like puncture. Like, it just sounds like those musicians are going insane with those instruments.
Yep. And that's Danny. And I think that that's, you know, going back to what Drew just said, is that's how you kind of have to be to make any type of mark in music. You have to just unapologetically be yourself 100% of time, no matter what other people demand of you.
Maybe he didn't, because he's coming from a different background or something, he wasn't so aware of, or not as afraid or something. It just has that feeling of just not, just kind of unbridled, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe
maybe a little ignorance
next time
is not
you
a bad
go
thing.
There. Ask him.
Well, you know, I think this brings us really neatly to Ruth's clip, because it's also a clip from someone doing their first ever film, coming out of, I don't know if you call her a pop musician, but certainly,
alternative.
A pure musical background. And coming in with something that was so bold that it immediately caught everyone's attention. So Should we play? Let's play the second clip from Under the Skin, please.
Yeah, you don't want to go in her bedroom.
No.
That's not a good one-night stand, is it?
It's a crazy movie.
That was her. So that's her second kill, or not kill, but hunt or seduction in the film. So if you haven't seen the film, it's kind of based on a really cool book, and it's nothing like the book actually, but it's sort of about this. So Scarlett Johansson is an alien who's basically taken on this woman's form, very attractive, and sort of hunts down unsuspecting men of any kind. And then sort of they end up in this, that weird sort of soup where they're just suspended and harvested for evermore. It's very strange. But she basically has to... or is compelled to, we don't know why, I'm not given any reasons, to, like, just draw them in and get them to like her. And when they come into her zone, then they just end up in this just weird place. And that's the end of them. And what I just love about it is when I first saw it, I mean, it's just a really bizarre film to watch because you don't know what the hell's going on. But it, when it got to those scenes, it's just... the combination of those, are like the black screen and that music, is just kind of like, I was like, what the hell's this? This is so weird and cool, and what's going on, you know? And so it took a few sort of almost like, didn't like it at first because like, what, it's so like in your face. And then I just thought it's so clever because it's kind of got the tune in there, which is like a seductive on the high violins, but it's so kind of scratchy and it's like seductive but yet kind of slightly nasty. It's quite dry, it's quite kind of, it's got sort of, you can hear the hairs on the bow. It's like, yeah, come hither, but something really wrong about that sound. And then that beat in the background, so it's so minimal. You've got that at the top and then just that beat. Doom, da, doom, you know, like almost a mixture of an electronic or, I'd love to know how she made that sound, but so minimal, those two things. It's like, it's almost a sound of like a snake, you know, like hypnotizing you before it's going to kill you, but it's sort of almost quite exotic and enticing. So it has that feeling of like being, drawing you in, but also deadly. And I like the way he's kind of coming out of the club and then into the scene. It's almost like it could be the beat that was playing in the club. But yeah, it's like the beat of death. But it's quite a nice sound as well. I just think it's really cool.
Well, I mean, music has this capacity, right? This capacity, right, Ruth, to be more than one thing at a time. It's like both of those things at the same time.
Exactly. And I really like that duality. It's not going, hey, it's horror. It's quite sweet, almost. It's sweet, but there's something weird about it. Like we were just talking about and all the other things. And there is a sort of almost Hitchcockian feel to a Herman-like feel. And I know that some of the other influences in the score were kind of Ligeti and Anarchist and some like composers that were, you know, used in The Shining. And that kind of sound that is associated with sort of horror. But the way she's done it is in a way that doesn't tell you that. It's sort of, and it also tells you something about this character kind of watching and learning, observing these men that she's pulling into her. So as the film goes along, that motif changes. So it starts off a little bit, it gets stronger and stronger as she gets used to this like act that she's doing, and then by the end it kind of fades and starts to crack as she becomes more aware of like, this is a bit fucked up and maybe humanity is, I shouldn't be doing this, you know. It's that whole idea of having a theme that changes and tells you something about the character, you know.
Can we talk about why it is that like really, really kind of bold, experimental, avant-garde classical music works so well with horror? Because, you know, there's like, there's this and there's The Shining and there's The Exorcist. And, you know, all that atonality seems to really fit a certain type of, well, I was going to say artsy horror film, but, you know, the Shining and, well, they're intelligent horror films, but they're mainstream horror films at the same time.
Yeah. we were talking about just on a purely harmonic basis, you know, like it's like the opposite of the God, you know, the harmonic series is like fifths and octaves. I don't know if you could play. I haven't got my piano lined up, but
yeah, we can do
you
it.
Know, the bum, bum, bum. So like at the beginning of 2001, you hear that, which is like, that's the harmonic series that occurs in nature. And if you keep going around all the keys in fifths, just keep going around the keyboard, you get to a tritone, which is the opposite. And that's that. Do you want to play the tritone?
Yeah.
On your keyboard, so just people know what that is. That's kind of like dissonant. It makes you feel uneasy. And in a lot of the horror films, it's that. Or the minor second that was in your first clip, the Vertigo clip. Mm-hmm. Da-na, which is also Jaws that we talked about. Yeah, it's like a crunch that makes you feel sort of slightly sick and, you know, not stable. Things are not stable, you know, that it's in, you're in the cracks. And like jazz music has a lot of it too, like Herman's chords have a lot of those kind of crunchy chords. It's sort of like, it's a bit funky. It can be funky, but it's also a bit disturbing. You know, and then you mix that up with some electronic sounds and then you're totally freaked out.
Hey, but you said that these, you know, these harmonies come from nature. Could you just expand a bit on that? And does that mean that it's kind of baked into our sort of, into our brains, what is musically pleasing?
Yeah, and in tubes or like, you know, like early instruments, or like if you're blowing through a tube and you just overblow the tube, you will just get those natural frequencies, harmonics occurring. That's what occurs if you strike an instrument in a certain way. Those intervals will resound.
There are multiples of the fundamental frequency. So if you have a frequency of 200 hertz, then the next note that you hear as a part of that note is 400, 600. It's a technical explanation, but
there you go. That's more scientific.
but anytime you play a single note, you're not just hearing that note. The things that make it sound like a piano or a flute or, you know, any other kind of identifiable instrument has to do with the strength of those, we call those partial harmonics. But as Ruth points out, basic kind of music theory, kind of arguably the two most important chords in music are, you know, right? The one and then the five. And that, you know, the fifth note of the scale happens to be that second partial. So the idea here is that harmony that fits within that naturally occurring series feels familiar, whereas if you start creating dissonances within that, it feels other, it feels uncomfortable. And Olly, I think that goes back to your supposition or your question, like, why is this avant-garde music that maybe seeks to kind of undermine some of these, you know, comfortable places, let's say. It is that idea of other. I mean, a great example of that, I wish I had the clip to play, is how famous composer Gheorghe Ligeti was used in 2001, right? And famously, his music was just kind of shoved into the film there. And it's these moments, these sequences in the film where we really want to have a sense that just something is other. It's just strange. It's just outside of our realm of understanding. And that goes to instrumental timbres as well. It's a fascinating aspect.
She used a lot of experimental techniques in this score. You know, like you were just saying, those kind of... she's a lot of violas and like a small string ensemble, and they're all kind of playing frenetically and like playing frequencies that are sort of rubbing against each other. And I think she also used microphones that were in each other's force fields. So there was like clashing of microphones as well, which is also like a kind of like technique that was used in like avant-garde contemporary music, but she's using it in a film score, which is really novel to go that far and to go that experimental and to be allowed to just really dive into a sound like that. I just thought that was amazing. And I think it was Jonathan Glazier who really sought her out and thought, okay, I don't really want to, or I think she thought he wanted a novice because he just wanted something completely different. But I think that she's doing herself down. I think it was like he heard something in her, what she'd already done, that sort of showed that she's a bit of a maverick, you know, when it comes to sound production.
Well, her music, her band, Mikachu and the Shapes, forgive me if I pronounced it wrong, it's pretty dissonant. Like, it's, you know, it's not traditional pop music. It's pretty out there, dissonant, you know, weird stuff.
Actually, I think it's fascinating.
In certain ways, it's weirder than this score. At least the score has, you know, a beat. It has, you know... As strange,
it's almost conventional. It has a tune, exactly. It has a tune, but some of the other bits of the score doesn't have a tune. But it weirdly does sort of draw you into the characters. But it does, even, you know, it's not just the tunes, but it's the whole texture of what she's doing that kind of just makes you want to watch the film and kind of question this alien, like, is it, what, why is it doing what it's doing? And it just makes you stay with the film. Otherwise, I don't think you would if the music wasn't there. You know, it's just so integral to it. It's another character. It is, you know, it represents, it's part of that psychological map that you're embodied when you're watching a film. You're not, it's not just the pictures. That's what I really strongly feel, like, you're making these characters 3D, you know, you're reaching people's subconscious in their heart and their minds, which I think music is kind of one of the, is very special in that way that it can do that, you know.
Right. Well, there's, you know, this famous saying that, you know, every art aspires to be music, because music is exactly what you've just described. It's pure. It's beyond visual identification. It's this pure form, and that's going back to music motion. That's why when you place that pure form of art that you've just described so eloquently with these visual images, like we've just seen in that clip, really extraordinary things can happen. Because the music is doing things that, you know, we can describe it and we can break it down, but there's always going to be a level where you can't explain it. It just is, and it just works because it works.
Yeah, but that's also like when you're writing music for something, it's almost like removing yourself from the process, and then until this thing works. So does it work for it or not? You know, you put something into what you feel and everything, and at some point it just works. Like, it is the character, you know, and then you can just... see it from a different perspective and go, okay, this is now something else. This is, and that's what's great about it. It's almost like lose your ego, you know, and just dive in.
Well, this is something that
we heard.
It's
getting deep.
Well, we heard this all year last year with you, Ruth, and with other composers who talked about, yeah, you get into this not for your own expression. You get into it to serve the film. You're a filmmaker. And Andy Milburn said, and I loved this quote. He said, you know, I don't consider myself a composer. I consider myself a filmmaker. And the ways in which if you get out of yourself as a composer, the ways in which you can open up a completely new way of experiencing the film, it's a really powerful and amazing thing to be a part of, isn't it?
Totally. Yeah.
Olly, I'm wondering, you know, opening up possibilities and the, you know, making things feel otherworldly and that kind of thing. Should we just play a little bit of this opening sequence to Forbidden Planet? Or do you want to move on to something else? Yeah. So.
No. I was going to say, let's go to one of your choices. So let's do it.
Well, so, I mean, so this is an example of a film, mid-20th century, first film really, kind of considered the first film to have an electronic music score. So one of the ways in which composers, as we've been talking about, will make things feel uncomfortable or otherworldly is by using dissonant harmony or something like that. But you can also just play with the sounds themselves. And composers in the middle 20th century were really exploring musical timbres from electronic media. And this is just a great example of how, you know, by today's standards, what would otherwise be kind of cheesy in terms of visual effects and that kind of thing, music can really kind of pull that suspension of disbelief forward by just being kind of out there and different and otherworldly. So this is Forbidden Planet, just the opening sequence. Freaky.
Okay. Have so we got? Has you're, Julia you're gone? By the way,
talk about this.
Well, yeah, we should. We
yeah,
should
Julia's
acknowledge.
Gone.
Yeah, we lost Julia. I think she. Oh. Julia's got a 9-month-old, so I think she was called off. But Julia, if you're still watching, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to getting you back on Music Motion sometime soon.
Oh, she's excellent.
Yeah, Julia was awesome. Her pancaking machine went insane. She had to peel off the pancakes off the ceiling. So, Drew, before you're going to talk about this, I just want to say that.
She just DM'd us. Here we go. Thanks, Julia.
Thanks.
Okay, Olly, go ahead.
This was like the first purely electronic score, and we were just talking about, actually interestingly, it connects to Under the Skin because it's as weird and out there. Think about seeing this in 1956 whenever this film came out. Like, you'd never heard anything like this before, and it's so interesting that the really really groundbreaking avant-garde stuff almost always comes out of what is regarded as cheap B-movie genre. And we're going to see that in the clip that I'm going to show after this, which is from Assault on Precinct 13. But, you know, often the really, really groundbreaking stuff comes from these small films. It's not the big Hollywood Oscar films or anything like that. It's the small films where people are working on the edges and they've got, and, you know, and often they're like looked down upon as being kind of lesser films. Horror films famously are. This type of B-movie sci-fi was. And that's where often the real inventiveness takes place. Well, tell us, what is it that you
that was
find
the kind
so
of the radio...
you know, exciting about that clip?
Well, I think you expressed it really clearly that, I mean, I don't know if the two of you feel this way, but I sometimes, whenever I'm have the opportunity to go into like a Gothic era church or you know, I go into a cathedral and see the media that's up on the wall, and I'm reminded like, wow, this was like for the people of that time, this was like, it's like going to a film or something like that, right? The stories that are depicted, everything is relative to what we've experienced, right? So I think your point about how in the mid 20th century these sounds would have been utterly, utterly foreign is really significant in terms of getting, you know, music and sound. We process it's such an emotional internal processing, right? And so if you're placed in that space where everything just feels unfamiliar, that is such a powerful place to be able to put a listener viewer for a director and filmmaker to be able to then kind of capitalize on that sense of place and space. So that's the thing that comes to mind to me when you look at a film like this, that we're just going to come right out of the gates in the opening credits in creating an emotional place, right? Right away, people are going to be put in a good position to experiencing feelings and thoughts and perceptions that they've not experienced previously. And I think this is something that music and sound have a unique capacity to do, because our experience of it so often is happening subconsciously, right? We walk into a room and we hear the acoustics of a space, and we there's so much that we take in just from walking into a room that is happening on a subconscious level that we don't even necessarily think about. So that's really what I think about when I hear this in the context of the period it was made. It's this deliberate sense where, like, we're going to take you to somewhere you've never been, and I think that having your audience in that place right out of the gate is a really powerful device for whatever, you know, creates a powerful capacity for whatever is going to follow.
Sorry, Drew. Do you know what the reaction was like? I mean, I was just like, I was like, really wish I was in the cinema when that first happened. You know, it's like, you know, The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky, and everybody threw chairs around, or so, you know, there was this famous riot in there, because I don't know if it was just the music or whether it was the sacrificial virgins on stage, because it was like quite a rude ballet going on at the same time. So I think the combination was just too much, and then people just threw their chairs around and then left.
Yeah, people can get really pissed off.
You know, what did they do? Did they get pissed off? Did they sit there? I wonder if some people walked out. Like, what is this? Are they still tuning? Are they doing some weird, like, tuning up of the, you know, sound or something? Is this meant to be happening? I'd love to know, you know. It's cool, isn't it?
it's such a famous film. I'm sure this has been written about. I'm sure there were reviews at the time, and I don't know the history of it. I'm ill prepared.
Yeah, it's just something I want to find out about now. You know,
yeah, I'm curious too.
And all of the things at the time, like the Radiophonic Workshop was kind of formed in the 1950s, and that was such a creative, you know, in terms of sonically, just really like they just let to be really creative, and just really kind of, because those sounds were so primitive, it's like no one knew what could be done with those sounds. So it's like, go for it, you know, because there's no precursors to it apart from what had been done in contemporary music with the organic instruments and then just sort of replicating those sounds with the machines, you know, with the synthesizers. And I've always been fascinated by that, like how a synth can sound like a viola or the other way round. You know, I just think this playing synths expressively, you know, is so powerful.
Well, I mean, it is such an important part of just the development of composition in the early 20th century, because, I mean, composers were trying to figure out new modes of expression. You know, everything in music, you know, is built on the shoulders of what came before. And many composers were really frustrated with traditional musical structures and harmonic patterns in music and the things that had been established, and they were desperate for ways to try to find new forms of expression. And many composers did a great job of this, just rethinking the way that they thought about melody and harmony in these different experimental systems, different ways of using the instruments themselves. But electronic music composers had this amazing opportunity, right? In that they could actually deal with the microstructure of the sound. Like not just what you do with the sound, but you actually get to design the sound itself and then decide musically what you're going to do with it. And this was completely revolutionary and changed composition. It was a turning point in composition with the ways in which technology allowed composers to do this was absolutely pivotal. And these things, of course, kind of trickle into popular media and as well. So, I think this example really embodies that kind of transitional moment in many different types of artistic expression.
Mm. Definitely.
And going back to what we were talking about earlier with the Under the Skin clip, there is something genuinely uncanny, unsettling about that piece that you just played. You know, there is something about those sounds, whatever they're doing, that just puts you in a very strange place. And that's beyond, you know, there's a part of it that sounds dated and 50s, and that's fine, but it's a genuinely great piece of music. There's a part of it that just is timelessly weird and uncanny. And like you were talking about all the modern composers and the atonality and the disharmony, it really just puts you on edge.
Mm-hmm. It's fun. It's really fun.
Okay. So, well, we're in the realm of genre, and we're in the realm of pure electronic score, and we're in the realm of groundbreaking pure electronic score. We're going to go to another clip, which is Assault on Precinct 13 by John Carpenter.
And this is one of your clips, right, Olly?
That's right.
Awesome. Here we go.
front.
Okay, Olly, what
classic!
Totally classic. What do you think, man?
John Carpenter, though, another legend. The obvious thing, legend.
Yeah.
Is the simplicity of it. You know, it's so spare and it's so simple. And yet, the way, because of that spareness, when it grows and when you get into the kind of the meat of that shootout, those, I don't know, the harmonies, they start rising there, it has real impact. And it kind of, as well as underpinning the action, it also has this sort of, you know, this almost emotional feel to it, that you know, these people are kind of connected together in this siege. And by the way, the influence of this soundtrack is, the impact of it is huge. And this is something that really, really fascinates me. The purity of the electronics of that connects it directly to hip hop in the early 80s, when hip hop was starting and people were doing these kind of live sets and rapping over the top. They really went for these like really spare electronic tracks to kind of rap to, and they went to people like Yellow and they went to Kraftwerk, and the John Carpenter scores were one of the things that they were playing in the early 80s in New York, in the Bronx. And then it went into an African Bambaataa track, then that transmogrified into European house, and there were several big house tracks that were based on this score. So it just had this kind of impact way beyond just the film. And I think a lot of that is to do with, there is a genius to that music. The spareness of the rhythm and the melody to it is just, it just gets in your head.
It's a good riff.
You guys can...
Isn't it? It's like a good riff.
Well, and Ruth, could you
I was going to say, like, it's not just a good riff, but you know, like, if you put something like that over the action, it's like, again, it's unexpected, isn't it? Because you're not scoring the action of the tension of it. It's going against it. So you're kind of the first bit sort of playing the tension because you've just got that. So you're waiting for when something going to change or drop, when's the beat going to come in or something. And then it goes into something. The chord sequence is almost slightly reassuring or emotional. But yet there's still this shootout going on. You know, that's what's so cool about it. I really like that. And it does sound like it's a track. You can see why people would have used that or sampled it, because it's just got a riff that you feel like as a song's going to start, you know. So that's a quality you're always wanting to achieve, and film music is like draw you in, as well as, you know, you're not just scoring the pictures, the action. It's saying something else. Like it's another journey right. that's going on.
And
you know, it's a track, but it's not a score.
It that's is. Pretty progressive, I just want to pick up what you're saying there, because it's cool. It's, you know, there's this thing beyond, yes, sure, you can write a piece of music that suits the drama and all of that. But there's also, it's just fucking cool. And
yeah.
And somehow, the fact it's fucking cool suits that action. You know, this kind of stripped down, pared down scene action. You know, super hyper urban. You know, it's beyond explanation. It's just right.
Yeah, but I wonder how they came at it, or how they, you know what I mean, like the process to finding that.
Well,
didn't you say something about John Carpenter not being able to afford, like something similar like that? He couldn't afford the forces or whatever. So
he had no money. So he made that film for $100,000. He had no money, and he wasn't a musician either. He had a really primitive keyboard, and the only way he could do music for his films was if he used this really primitive keyboard, because he couldn't afford an orchestra, he couldn't afford instruments, he couldn't afford a band. And apparently it took a while, because back then the equipment was so old school that just to kind of program in really basic riffs kind of took 3 days. So he only ever had
that's pretty nuts to start off with, isn't it? To do that. Himself, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
and the film only has two themes because he didn't have the time to do any more. So he just reuses that theme again and again.
Yeah.
Which works. And then people follow and study it. Going back to what you were saying, it's so cool and stripped down. You know, part of coolness is just being too cool. You know, Ryan Gosling's made a career of this, being too cool to have any expression whatsoever. You just sit there smoking a cigarette, staring at people. And this is kind of like the musical equivalent of that, right?
Yeah.
Well, there's something, I mean, every good media composer I know understands the need to sometimes, to understand that sometimes less is more. And Ruth, I'm wondering, would you share with us, I mean, Olly, you point this out, that there's an economy of materials, right? There are just few musical materials. Ruth, could you talk to us about when you first learned that, like sometimes doing less is really what is, or even give an anecdote to that?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, cause you know, this is a common mistake that students make, right? When they're first trying to like learn how to score for film, they come in and the music is just all over the place, and it's stepping all over the drama.
Oh, yeah.
This is a great example of how, like, just a hi-hat, right, with some distortion on it, does so much.
Oh, yeah, totally. There was this, like, director who, he would just be so rude. Not you, Olly. And a different...
I was like, where's this going?
For viewers...
That sounds like... Yeah. Yeah, go on.
For those of you who don't know, Ruth and Olly have worked together professionally, so this is one of the reasons this conversation is so friendly, right? Between all of us, so it's all friends here. But please carry on.
But it really was. You know, we didn't ever have these moments of kicking. You know, this director used to kick the back of my chair. you know, just like he's just to say, what the hell's that? Like, is this supposed to be the beginning of a spy movie? It sounds like goblins dancing around a maypole. You know, why have you got all this stuff going on? And then, oh no, this is so bad because I've orchestrated this thing and it's got strings and it's got this and that. And then, but then if I thought it was a good idea or this piece I thought was, there's something in it, I just started like muting things. And this is in the days where the director would actually come round. Like nowadays, no one comes round. It's all, things are too fast now. You just send it all into the ether, right? So we just started to take out what the goblins and the maypoles until we were just left with the bass line and a tune, you know, just the bare bones of it. And he's like, all right, that's all right now. That's a bit better now, you know. Like, you know, sometimes it is in there and sometimes, yeah, it's just shit and you should start again, you know. But I think there's a tendency, he would go, why you keep hiding? You know, like, I think your music's great, but why do you keep dressing it up with all this stuff? It's like you're scared of something, you know. Just let's clear out the shit and boil it down to its essence, you know. So, you know, I always try and think about that. What is essential? What's really driving this piece? Well, that, you know, get rid of the.
That is a. I find that's a common thing, and we've had it when we've worked together. I've had it with every composer I work with. That particularly now, I think, where the ability to provide tracks and stems is such that, you know, I often find almost always that the first tracks that come in are just, they have too much. And the biggest part of the process is peeling stuff away. And there's, you know, that's a part of, I just think that's a part of the modern process, is peeling back stems and kind of streamlining stuff. And we've done that together. What's interesting about the John Carpenter film is that and again, like we were talking about with other stuff, whether you could, with melody and stuff, whether you could do that today, but he just came in there and he was like, I'm just going to do one thing. And he did the same on Halloween. He did the same on a lot of other films where it's so pared down and simple that I think if you turned up to a mixing studio today with that, people would freak out.
They'd be where are the other stems? Have you got any more orchestra to add to this? Where are the other stems? It's just
It's so
just
bare. Two. There's nowhere to hide.
So bare. Yeah, I think you're right. They'd be struggling with, especially in cinema, it's an expectation to kind of, it's got to have the low booms, it's got to have the strings at the top. It's especially in a big kind of action film like that, you're kind of expecting this big sonic experience, you know. So I think they would be like going a bit nuts, like, well, yeah,
right.
But it'd be great to see if it could be done on a big mainstream film, you know.
Yeah.
Space.
No, you'd have to have, you know, balls of steel, because there would be a lot of people to convince.
Just saying, people will walk
out.
But
Carpenter shows, you know, Halloween's one of, if not the most successful horror film in history. You know, Assault on Precinct 13 was immensely successful. And he shows that you can do it, and you can do it with huge impact. And what's interesting is it is a bit different, although it's experimental and it's ahead of its time. It's very different to all the atonal stuff that we've been talking about with other horror films, Ligeti and everything. This is, you know, it's maybe providing more drive than horror, but it's definitely providing tension.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think he started a new genre, didn't he, with that kind of a riffy type of thing. That on Halloween, you know, it's again a sample, something that's sampled to death. Very catchy, but slightly psychotic type of riff.
Right.
You know?
Yes. And it worms itself into your mind.
It worms in. It's repetitive, and it's like it's going to get you. That riff is going to get you. Like when you shut your eyes at night, it's still there. You know, freaky. Yeah. I mean, that's the ultimate film music, stays with you after the film, doesn't it?
Well, isn't it interesting, too, how we started with Bernard Herrmann, and like this completely intricate musical expression, and we ended up with a hi-hat, right? And I think it illustrates how there's so many different ways these two art forms can kind of merge and interact with one another. I don't think the Bernard Herrmann was any more of a compelling example than this example from Assault on Precinct 13. It's just about what's being called for.
But it's almost like we planned this, isn't it?
Almost.
But we didn't.
Almost.
It just had a kind of theme. Yeah. It was great.
Well, and this
coherence.
We've been at it for 2 hours. Olly, I'm wondering if you're going to let me leave us with the rhythm of the night. Are you gonna let us do both the Potravai?
Drew, of course I will. I would never take the music away.
Okay. Well, so I guess we'll close with this one. And this last example. And by the way, for all of you who've stuck with us, thank you for joining us today. We're going to do one more example here, and then we'll sign off. This is from a film. What year was this done? 1985. That was the famous song written by Diane Warren that was recorded by this group called DeBarge. I think that's how you pronounce them. Is it DeBarge?
It's DeBarge. I spent many a cheesy disco.
Okay, good.
Listening to DeBarge, yeah.
And, you know, we haven't actually talked much about licensed music in film. It's a huge, huge part of music in film where pop songs will be licensed and kind of appropriated and inserted into a film for the sake of kind of pulling in something that's already culturally relevant and that people are familiar with. And then you bring it into a film and it reframes the meaning. And this example of Rhythm of the Night in this film Beau Travail is a great example of this. This is a really great French film about an officer in the French Foreign Legion who ends up having an antagonistic relationship with one of his reports. The report disappears. Everyone thinks that he's dead. This scene that we're going to play is actually at the very end of the film, where this officer is about to be court-martialed and is kind of contemplating his circumstances, and he's dedicated his life to the military. There's a quote that is put out right before we're going to see in this point of the film, where he says, "Serve the good cause and then die." And he's holding this gun. So it's clearly like implying that he's thinking about the end of his career and maybe the end of his life. And then this really upbeat R&B disco song from the 80s comes in, Rhythm of the Night. There's another lyric that says, "This is the rhythm of my life." So there's this song and this lyric that just interjects a lot of meaning and leaves us with a great sense of kind of ambiguity and a question, because it cuts to this officer actually being in like a disco dancing to this song. And so it's somehow maybe representing what his subconscious is doing in this moment. It's a great kind of abstract moment that at the end of an interesting film that kind of leaves you with a lot of questions. So we're just going to play the end of Beau Travail here.
Sers la bonne cause et meurs.
The rhythm of the night. This is the rhythm of my life. My life. Oh yeah. The rhythm of my life.
I want what he's on. I mean, that move at the end, that's
good
something.
Dancing.
It's good dancing.
Yeah, it's amazing.
My head
dancing.
Would go straight into that mirrored wall. I'd be like,
yeah.
Oh, Undeniable Ops has said exactly the same thing. I want what he's having.
Great.
Well, yeah, so I love, there's so many different aspects of this. First of all, I love, you know, we really haven't really talked about dance yet in any of our episodes. And Olly, this is something that we should really think about, you know, all different forms of motion, right? And this synthesis of dance and pop music and integrating it this way to kind of wrap up this story. I just think it's a really unique example. That was actually recommended to me for this episode. I wasn't familiar with it before this episode, but I thought it was a really compelling example.
I haven't seen the film, so nothing like that happens before. Like, they don't use any tracks in the film until that point.
There are some scenes where they're in, where they're dancing. They're in a, you know, they're in. So the discotheque is part of the storyline. Olly, you're familiar with this film, aren't you?
I am, but it, like I was saying before, it's been a long time, and literally, the scene that I remember most is what you just played. That's the scene. I just remember there's lots of stuff of sort of guys mumbling in barracks.
It's dark.
And sun,
yeah.
But
well, that's
but
the other thing.
What I remember. Yeah.
Go ahead, Olly.
No, I was just saying that this scene was undeniably the one that had the most impact.
It's very upbeat too, and very kind of life affirming, this song, right? And in a sense, it's kind of being, again, it's kind of creating this tension where, like, this song has a certain implication, but this guy's like got a gun on his chest thinking about ending his life. So it's that kind of tension that can come, you know, that, you know, a really great, I mean, Tarantino does this all the time in terms of licensed, you know, tracks in his films.
I was going to say that. That's what it reminds, you know, that's the kind of what Tarantino does so well. It's like kind of marriage of, you know, selective music and different.
But I would argue that this is doing something different, you know, to Tarantino. This is an art film, you know. It's a classic European art film. You know, it's not people blowing each other's brains out to pop music.
Well, but it's dark, isn't it? He's going to die. He said he's going to like top himself.
Yes, it's dark. But it's not poppy, and Tarantino is poppy, and this is, you know, a reflection of the guy's inner state and his sort of damaged masculinity and his inability to express himself. And the end of the film, he's finally expressing himself. It's actually very similar. If anyone's seen, there's a movie out right now that's getting a lot of, you know, award nominations in Britain called After Sun, which does a very similar thing. Again, about a damaged guy suffering from depression seen through his daughter's perspective. And it ends in a very similar way with him dance, sort of letting loose at a rave. It is using source. And I guess it just goes to say that source music can be used in a lot of different ways. There's the Tarantino way where, you know, you cut off an ear to a famous pop song and, you know, rake in a lot of cash. And then there's this where you use the pop song kind of as a counterpoint, you know, and this really cheesy kind of mainstream pop song is counterpointed with a very, very kind of dark kind of psychological comment about masculinity. I don't think Quentin Tarantino is making dark psychological comments about masculinity.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, you don't think that's kind of fucked up to put like an upbeat song over cutting someone's, like the kind of wildness of it, you know, like the joy of violence or whatever, something about that. It's just like, here's a cool song and I put it over this. You don't think it's a comment?
I mean,
it was so kind of shocking at the time because it kind of makes people laugh at something that they shouldn't and kind of makes it even more violent or something. You know, because it's
you
poppy.
Just said it's the joy of violence. It's like, you know, having
there's something in there that's about, that's something in the human spirit that finds that joyful, you know, that shouldn't. I think it's that horrible bit, you know, you don't want to think is part of us.
Well, it's the part that no one wants to look at, right?
Yeah.
And the medium, the filmmaking itself, provides that one point of separation that allows us to explore things that we wouldn't maybe explore otherwise, perhaps. And this shows how music is, can be a really important part of that. Anyway, so
love it.
Okay, so Undeniable Ops.
Let's all go and dance to that now.
Well, Undeniable Ops said this is the part where Ruth reveals she's a dancer as well as a composer.
Yeah, here we go. Spotlight on me. I'm going to end the show. No, I'm not. What a feeling.
Well,
or face Ruth, plant on my foot. No.
Ruth, I just have to thank you for being a part of our longest Music Motion ever. We've been going for 2 hours and 15 minutes.
We bust the 2 hour mark.
It's gone by quickly. And we could probably keep on going. I think we'll wrap it up for today. And Ruth, we're gonna keep our eyes on what you're doing and our ears on what you're creating. And thanks so much for the time today.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it. Actually, it's really fun to talk about film music in this way and see what other people. You know, I really enjoyed hearing what Julia had to say, and it was just really interesting.
Awesome.
Let me come back on some point. That'd be great.
We'd love to have
and
you
thanks
back
also
on.
Like to be to the text support from Shannon and B as well.
Absolutely.
Some very
Absolutely.
Good comments.
Yes.
Thanks for all the DMs.
Yeah, Shannon saying I definitely have some new movies and composers to check out. Thank you guys.
Awesome.
Excellent. Awesome.
All right, Ruth, we'll bid you farewell for now.
Bye.
Okay, we'll talk to you soon.
Thanks for having me. Bye.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Ruth.
All right, Olly, that's our first jukebox. There'll be a lot to debrief on later. But you and I need to talk a little bit. Tell everyone a little bit about what's happening next month. Something really unique is happening.
Yeah, we're gonna do a special from Prague, which is a home of music. And is also a rich, rich culture of film, and film music, and also theater and music, and dance and music, and modern visual arts and music. And we're going to be joined by a composer called Aleš Pržina, who I've worked with on the show Dangerous Liaisons, who is a fantastic composer in his own right, who's done over 20 films, as well as stage plays and concerts and other pieces. And we're going to have a couple of other guests as well. And we're going to talk and really dig into this other film culture. So much of our stuff has been focused on American and on British work. We're going to explore another culture, an East European film culture with a very rich history.
Yeah, it's going to be fantastic. And it will be their first Music Motion episode where we're actually meeting synchronously in person. So I'm going to be there. Do you know if you're going to be there at the end of next month, or are you going to be joining us from Los Angeles or somewhere else? I'm going to be in Prague. Where are you going to be?
We'll see.
Okay.
I definitely want to be in Prague.
Awesome. Well, we will look forward to that next month. Everyone tune in on the 26th. It's the 26th, right? Yes, the 26th. And with that, we will, again, thank you everybody for joining us. Thanks for everyone who messaged into the episode. This was a great time today. So with that, we will bid you all farewell until next month. Bye, Olly.
Yeah, see you, Drew, and thank you, everyone.
Okay.